Okay, I think it's time to start now. First of all, I want to thank the organizers for preparing the stage, for letting me into this conference. I want to speak about a topic which does not exactly fit into the headline of this track. It's not a Neo4j deep dive thing, it's more something which guides us towards using Neo4j in a context which is sometimes seen in industry right now. So we have a business use case where metadata integration across multiple Hadoop systems was a big problem. We wanted to solve this. And during one customer project, I worked on this topic. I want to speak about this here in this session. First, before we go into the technical details, I want to introduce myself quickly. My name is Mirko. I work as a solution architect with Cloudera. And my personal interest is question answering systems. This is sometimes about semantic search, semantic knowledge representation, and so. And in order to get there, I did some background work. I studied physics and worked a lot with time series and network analytics in the past. And the outcome of my work was, some publications as shown here. But during this work, it was sometimes pretty suffering. The management aspect, managing your data, get your data right, get your data into the right place, get the right tools in your hands, get the knowledge to use the stuff in the right way. This was a nightmare in some cases, and this drove me to rethink the process. What are we doing wrong if we do data science? And we can learn a lot from data engineers and from software engineers because they have established procedures, they have well-established processes, good tool chains, and so on. And the goal was to build something or to enable people to suffer less while they do data science. Our approach is simple. We use a multi-layer metadata integration system. This did not exist in the beginning. It emerged over years, and the results are shown here already. On the right-hand side, you see a graph or a picture which shows you our knowledge representation, just a little tiny excerpt of what we can collect. It is using Neo4j for the user interaction, but behind the scenes, in order to get the knowledge into this format, there was a lot of engineering to be done, and the project we the talk is about building this multi-layer infrastructure. The four layers we speak about contain cluster-specific metadata. The Hadoop cluster, for example, our CDH clusters, they come with a lot of monitoring and auditing features, and this metadata is managed automatically. That's solved this problem. Next one, Hadoop-specific operations. They come from log files. Log data is available in Hadoop. This problem can also be seen as solved. But then, individual applications have very specific operational logs, operational process metadata, which is not stable, which can change over time because the processes change over time. All the stuff has to be tracked somehow, and there was no standard solution available yet. And finally, if we do something cool with data, people ask, what's the quality of your process? Can you repeat it? How expensive would it be to scale it? And all these questions come in data-driven businesses, and our goal is to answer those questions. And in order to do so, we must integrate data and knowledge from these four layers into one single system. The current status of the project is as follows. We use Neo4j and Cypher to do context exploration. And in order to do context exploration, we first must figure out what is the context of a single piece of information. We need contextualization, and we need this across multiple systems. It's not enough to have stuff in a metastore for one Hadoop cluster only. There is such a thing like the Hive metastore. But what about a company which uses multiple Hadoop clusters? How to integrate all this stuff from multiple clusters, from multiple departments, from multiple people? It's about knowledge sharing, and we try to build something for this. So the idea is, start with an idea, with a vision to improve data science. And one thing we want to achieve is, we want to become data-driven. What does it mean? You should treat your data as a resource, not just something you work with. Data is, in some cases, the core of your business, or it will be the core of your business. And we should also think about data set life cycles. The data, as it is sometimes very stable. In other cases, data evolves over time. And all this dynamics has to be somehow considered. And people do industrial procedures for centuries. Mining is such an example. Mining was something where people did hard labor, and nowadays mining is a important industry, and what comes out of mining drives the whole economy. It is oil, it is coal, it is all kinds of material which go into processes, and people use computers, not for mining, but people use computers nowadays to do data mining, because the volume of data grows and grows, and in order to manage the facts and stuff which is inside this data, it is sometimes not possible to get it out because you don't know what you can get out of the data. It's something totally new which has to be managed somehow, and this is why some people say data is the new oil. It can also drive a new industry, and if we go a little bit forward and say, okay, data is the new oil, let's ask ourselves, who of us is buying oil except for heating? We use products made from oil. The same belongs to data. Data is essential, but data products use data in order to give you some other benefit, some other value. And this kind of industry is in front of us. And the idea is, if we say data is the new oil, we could also say metadata are the nuggets and brilliance. Not everybody has it, but many people want it. And you could think about processes. You get something with not so much effort. You can get materials by just digging into the earth, and then you have to do something with it. And this procedure, this transformation process is what matters, and it gives you something better than you have had before. And the combination of different ingredients, of different materials, resources, and also combined with skills, allow you to build fine, nice things like this diamond ring. The same can be translated to data. We start also with a bunch of tools. Here, to build a diamond ring, you might need such tools. In order to do data work, we need a Hadoop stack, maybe other technologies combined with this Hadoop cluster. This is what we usually do with our customers. We have a tool set. People are familiar with the tools after a certain time, but they are not yet data-driven. Just being able to run jobs on a Hadoop cluster doesn't mean that your business or your company is already data-aware. And this is what we have to change. And the idea is, think data-driven, build a long-term strategy around your data, not about your tools, not about the investment you have to do to buy computers, data centers, and so on. It's much more important to go one level up, to think about your knowledge and your data, which is bundled in this location, which is managed in this technology. And you must make your data accessible. That's a very important aspect. Just having the data somewhere, laying around in the corner, doesn't help you. Your data must be accessible, and there are different aspects of accessing your data. Being able to process the data is one part. This is what Hadoop gives you. But being able to find what you already know and what you have, and to be aware of what you know, this is a different aspect, and we have to work on this in the future. An example is, if you look to Google, the goal of Google was to make the internet content available and accessible to everybody. And in this sense, you should become your own Google. You should care about your data management procedures. And this data management procedures mean that your data is something very essential. You have to track your data. You have to manage data about your data. You derive more data from your existing data and metadata. And then at the end, you combine all this. And this is like a manufacturing process. You take multiple ingredients, you bring stuff together, and the process of doing this is something which can be optimized. And this is where you can gain more money, or even lose less, if you can optimize these things. And at the end, you can think about cloud-based operations. For example, Wikipedia shows you how this works. The Wikipedia project has a huge amount of content. This content on its own is a valuable data. But there is more around it. The structure between the articles in Wikipedia, the metadata about how the content is generated, the discussions between multiple people around an article, and the access history. How often was the article loaded by users? How often was an article changed by editors? All this information is valuable metadata. And now you would say, what should I care about this? I don't have Wikipedia. But think one step forward. Every company has enterprise content management systems. You have Salesforce and all these other nice tools, and all have one thing in common with Wikipedia. There is metadata about it. You can track it, but not so many people do it. A lot of our customers track metadata actively. They call it log analytics. This is a lesson which was learned. People are open to log analytics, and the whole industry grows around this topic. And now we want to go one step forward. It's not about the technical logs. It's about the knowledge of the scientist, the knowledge of the people doing stuff. This must be tracked somehow. And here, I want to go a little bit into the scientific field and rethink what is science. Science is defined, according to Wikipedia, as a systematic enterprise that builds and organizes knowledge in the form of testable explanations and predictions about the universe. That's crazy. Science is about the universe. Okay, we all are part of the universe, and there are so many different aspects which are all covered by science. This is a nice definition, but very unspecific. In our industry, people like to talk about data science. My observation was, if you talk to our customers, data science could be defined by translating the definition of science from Wikipedia in this way. Data science is more or less the same thing what science is, but focused on market and business context. Okay, that's nothing new, but now we have a starting point. We have something in common with normal science. Data science is not that specific. Knowledge generation, knowledge management, and being repeatable, do things which are testable, and try to predict something. This is something which is in common for data science and normal science. And scientists look into the nature. Biologists just take their eyes, they go out and observe what they can see. They can zoom in by looking into the details. They can zoom out by going back or coming back at a later point in time. And why are they doing this? They do nothing else than context generation. They think about an object, they observe it, they observe the neighborhood, they track changes over time to get a better, bigger picture. This is what scientists, what human beings normally do in order to survive, in order to get something crazy new. Results are visualized. Visualizations are done for centuries. 500 years ago, when book printing became a standard, society changed. And what is the benefit of having a book and being able to replicate knowledge in multiple languages, not only in languages like English language, German language, or whatever other spoken language? You can use the visual language, and this is what people use. And people like graphs and charts and images and so. And the way how we generate these things has not changed dramatically. While the biologist observed nature by eye, we look into data. And this is more or less a very specific fact of data science. We do not start an experiment to get the data in. Normally, data science gets some data, and then they start working on this stuff. And the paradigm is exactly the same. You look into something, you observe, you extract something which looks like a pattern. Maybe you call it now a fact, because this fact comes again and again, and you believe that this is something which is a, let's say, a standard, or which is predictable over time. And then you repeat this, you track your procedure to make it repeatable, and only if you track how you do it, you can show it to your colleague how he can do it. That's essential, and we can learn this here. And if we say scientific work is like an art, there is no very well-defined process, only a partial process. And then we must be open to two things. We must be able to allow variations, to allow flexibility and so on. And what our first approach or our first concept in our tool is, we start with data, transform data into facts, and combine facts into knowledge, which then can be presented. That's a very generic idea, and we see it in multiple places. The question is now, how did we do it? Yeah, we built a system which is based on Hadoop. It's an open source project called Etosha, and we focus on a graph model, on an open graph model, and all this stuff should be data-centric, not based on a particular technology or programming language or graph representation or whatever. Our goal is to build a toolset which manages a data science process, which collects facts and information in the knowledge graph and allows you to become data-aware if you use this toolset. In the beginning, we started on Hadoop and on tracking meta information about Hadoop-specific assets. Our graph processing engine was Giraffe in the beginning. Nowadays, it's replaced. We don't use Giraffe anymore. We are now working on Neo4j. But both together, the Hadoop and the Giraffe logos, they drove us to think, how should we call this project? And the idea was, we need a place on Earth where giraffes and elephants live together. An idea could be a zoo, but Zookeeper was already used as a project name, so we could not do it. Finally, we ended up with the name Etosha, which is a national park in Africa. Nice elephants and giraffes live there. This is just the background to switch our mindset to what we see now. Now I want to speak about what the Etosha project is and how we do the things. If I could switch on. But for some reason, it is not working. So our process, the data science process model, is in the center of the Etosha project. What we do is we specify artifacts, we describe assets, so-called data assets, and we describe transformations. Something what other tools also do. The UZI workflow management uses the same concept, but the purpose is a different one. The one system describes this processing graph to implement and to do the analytics. In our context, we describe the graph to gain knowledge and to keep track of the knowledge. And this allows us to repeat the execution of several processes. In the future, I think we should be able to automatically generate new programs from the knowledge graph based on specific queries. So the idea is you should support data scientists by enabling them to log information. Like servers log a lot of things, data scientists should be able to log stuff in a very standardized way so that they are not interrupted. Our design is as follows. We specify a simple process model, describe it by an ontology, build a toolset around it which uses the ontology like a bridge, and the specific, domain-specific process model is independent of the toolset. If you go to a different industry, if you go to a different style of interaction, you just change the rules of interaction between the assets, and then you can reuse our concept. This flexibility is important in order to get people on board. The key idea is called semantic logging. Instead of just writing log4j content into a logging collection framework where strings are typically used, we try to structure our information as early as possible. We can start with a standard which says use a property which has a name and a value, express it as a key value pair, and write it in a structured form into your logs. This is doable, but it requires you to pass this stuff later on. We want to avoid complexity, and we want to use standards. So the idea is take your knowledge, what you already have in mind, what you have already defined as variables, and dump those into your knowledge graph. Data science tools use this approach. They show you a list of all variables. They show you a list of the history of variables. And now you can get your context back by looking into this tool. We want this same behavior as a very generic feature. Semantic logging is implemented in our tool stack, which looks like this in the block chart. We say the orange box, which is our contextualization framework. This keeps track of what you know already. And now it can be integrated into the data science workbench, for example. You can type something in your console, and by tracking what you type in, like the bash history is doing, you can collect your procedures without interruption. You don't have to open a Word document or Evernote or whatever. You just do your work, and the toolset in the background logs things according to the process definition you work with. And this allows us to observe information during the creative procedure and also during production. We can hook in into the workbench, into Spark Shell. We can hook also in into Spark streaming processes or even in Apache Flume or Kafka pipelines and derive flow information on the fly, on the non-technical level, but on the level where the meaning of the data is already known. This gives us the final architecture. The blue box on the top and the bottom right is our CDH stack. It comes with the first two metadata management layers. Cloudera Manager and Cloudera Navigator are the two lower levels we work with. This is a standard which all our customers or many of our customers use. And then we start building the operational processing layer on top, and the red in the highest level, this is our knowledge graph. This knowledge graph is populated from technical and non-technical metadata. It gets enriched from our toolbox, and this integration of person-specific and technical data gives you a much broader view and a wide context. And using Neo4j here as a store for keeping all the facts in a graph model allows us to use Cypher for querying the stuff and also for exporting via RDF to other existing knowledge management tools like Apache Jenner. We have seen in the last presentation how easy it is to use Neo4j for exporting an RDF graph. And exactly this concept is here behind the project, to use RDF as an exchange format, to use Neo4j as the query engine to keep the knowledge graph and to work on the knowledge graph. And then we must integrate all this into the Hadoop stack in a way which has no impact on users. Users should not see at the end that they use this kind of semantic locking. It should be as transparent as possible to them. Okay, our achievements so far, we have implemented this in one company. The company is not, they do not want to be announced here. And in the beginning, it was a private hobby project which transformed to a little bit more work over the time. We are able to reuse existing components a lot. So we built query beans as a higher level abstraction on top of the indexing engine and on top of the graph processing engine. We want to decouple the things as good as possible. And we can think about integration of knowledge from multiple disciplines, from multiple customers, spanning multiple Hadoop clusters. That's the final goal. Not being limited to one cluster only, but doing this as an enterprise knowledge aggregation layer. And from there, you can integrate into existing systems which you have. In order to achieve this, our next steps are to improve this implicit triplification. This means we want to export existing metadata from existing low-level metadata stores in an automatic way into the knowledge graph. And we have to balance out. Not everything has to be exported. We must find a good balancing between what stays in the existing layers and what is pushed up to the next level. And this is some work which has to be done. We want to integrate into existing ontologies to adjust to very different processing workflows. And finally, the goal is to grow a little community or even a growing community around the project in order to enter the Apache incubator in the near future. So that's all about how it was implemented or how it was conceptualized. Here is again this picture which shows Neo4j and how we can easily explore the context of a data asset. Our data asset, for example, are four blue bubbles here in the middle. The data sets are raw data, training data set, and also some derived data. And in order to clean up and to process the data sets, you need multiple different procedures. Such transformations, which are technical procedures, are represented here as a red bubble. And each of the operations can be owned by different people, represented as the green bubble. And this is just a simple example how you can dive into your data structure, into your processes, if you just collect the facts at the right point in time. And the idea is to avoid additional overhead for parsing and extracting all this stuff in an additional step. If we do data science, we know all this stuff already. At this point in time, we want to capture the information and push it in a very direct path, in an ideal world, from the mind of the researcher into the knowledge graph. And we do not want to go down into the log files, parse the log files again. In order to populate the knowledge graph, we want to capture what we know on the highest level as possible. That's the concept, that's the idea. And that's also the last idea of this talk. Thank you for coming in and for listening.